bring me out here again?
Java.
Java. Oh yeah, Java. I remember because you accidentally put Java as your name.
Yeah, I didn't do the form right. So I So Java and I'm Maria.
Awesome. And then how old is Java?
He's nine.
Nine. Oh wow.
Yeah.
Big boy.
Yeah.
So we're gonna fill me in on Java.
So for like the first 5 years of Java's life, I had him, and he was well trained. You know, he went to puppy class and, you know, sit and walks on, and we went to the puppy park, and pretty solid, no aggression at all. Then I had to go to Florida for promotion for a year and a half, and because of his short nose and his like overheating, I decided to leave him with my parents.
Okay.
And then I came back, and the apartment I had didn't allow dogs, and then I got married and my husband wasn't a fan of dogs. So for like the last three-ish years, a little bit, he's been with my parents.
Mm-hmm.
Then now that he's getting sick and he's getting more allergies and I have my own house now, my parents just can't keep up with his like care that I used to.
Mm-hmm.
And they let his paw get infected. And I'm to blame as well, you know, because I could have fixed it as well and mm-hmm. gone. So now I'm taking care of him full time because the medical bills are so expensive. And I was just like, I think I dropped like $1,000 at the vet because of something that could have been prevented, right? But then I'm like taking him on walks, and like I just felt like I could have started back where he was. And like another dog will come by and he'll like pull and get aggressive. And then I was like, well, let's just go to the dog park, and like maybe that's just because he's walking. And then like the few times I went to dog park, there was only one or two dogs there, so it wasn't like a huge amount of dogs. And he started like bullying the other dogs, mm-hmm. or like just, you know, doing the aggressive behavior. And I would say those dogs weren't necessarily aggressive, but he egged them on. So then one of the bigger dogs like started to like attack him a little bit, but he didn't really let down. And then it kind of scared me because like, I know you're not supposed to put him away or anything, and like I just got scared, and then I could get hurt too.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Then we went to dog park, and I was like, maybe that was just one day, and that one dog was only there, this huge dog park. And then the other day went, and there was a little dog with a muzzle on, and he was like, I guess he had aggression issues, but I had him on the leash the entire time, and I was just like trying to socialize him to the dog park. And no one else was there. And then that dog came with his muzzle and started attacking Java.
Oh, God.
And it was a pug. So like, basically, this actually ended up coming off because mm-hmm. I was like trying to grab him. That pug had a muzzle.
Yeah.
But it was so fast that this isn't even that loose at times, but it came off. Like I couldn't even get a hold of my dog at that point. So at that time I was like, well, this isn't working. Like, you know, maybe I could do YouTube videos and all that stuff, but I'm like, ultimately I'm like concerned for his health and then also my own, because if I am pulling him away or trying, or maybe not doing it right, I could definitely put myself at danger. And then he just like turns into a bully, and he was never like that like the first 5 years that I had him consistently. He was a really good dog.
Okay.
So my parents didn't train him, they didn't walk him. They let him be whatever he wants. He got kind of fat, like, so I'm kind of just trying to do course control.
Yeah.
And like just, you know, go on walks in the neighborhood and not be embarrassed because I just never had that before, and now I'm like, oh my gosh, how would I handle it?
Yeah.
So yeah, that's that. And then like, my dad kind of has like, when he says like attack or like playing around with him, my dad's pretty old school, so like I guess they kind of like encourage him to be a bully. So like, and like they have a dog that barked at everything, so like he picked up that habit.
Mm-hmm.
But and then my brother just bought a dog, and we can't even have, like, so my parents had him, and then I finally took him back like 2 months ago. Prior to that, my brother's dog would come over. It's a Labrador, a Golden Doodle.
Mm-hmm.
Super playful baby, like, but it's like 3 times bigger than him. He wants to kill her. Like, he has no reservations about trying to attack her.
Yeah.
So, and I would say his bite isn't harder. Like, he's not, like, he's never bitten me. but he's tried to bite like two people.
Like snapped?
Snapped. He more snaps because I don't think he really bites because he can bite, but he hasn't bitten anyone or hurt anybody since the 9 years.
Okay.
He just gets like aggressive.
I see. But he's never bit a person, he's never bit a dog.
He's never bit a person, and I actually have never seen him bite a dog. I see him snap and like lift up his chest and like just like growl.
Yeah.
But he's never like, I've never had anyone like, I'm there, right? So he doesn't really get to bite. Like his mouth isn't like, usually he's messing up with bigger dogs who try to like scare him sometimes. So like he then just kind of just like, just does the like a boxing weave, like in and out, like.
Oh, okay.
Like he just wants to fight them for some reason.
Okay. And then when you say bully, like what does he do?
Like he just like runs up to them, starts to smell their butt, and then he's like not feeling it, and then he starts going.
And does he pursue the dog or is the dog?
He pursues the dog. Okay. Like he just doesn't. So like you know like I guess like when I remember when I sang in South Park, they would sniff their butts and then they'd be like, cool, run around. So he starts that, and then he's like, no, I don't like you. So like the first 5 or 10 seconds, everything looks fine. In my opinion, of course, not trained. And then that, like in a millisecond, he like doesn't like it anymore. And the other dog, I guess, is doing like the same thing, like checking each other out. And then all of a sudden he just gets into like attack mode.
Okay.
Some dogs don't have it, some dogs do. Some are so oblivious and that they're just playing around that they don't even pay him any attention.
Okay.
But it's the ones that let him provoke him then. That he gets more, yeah.
Okay.
And this is all brand new. He wasn't like this before, so it's kind of
So it could have been like a setback when he was at your parents, and then have you always walked him on a harness?
So I stopped walking him on this, like a collar.
Regular collar.
Because he was recently, since I've had him for the last 2 months, I've retrained him how to walk better. He was trying to lead me and like pulling and like so many bad behaviors. So I finally kind of got him back to like walk side by side. He walks like a little bit behind me. He doesn't pull on me too much at all with this. But then he was getting allergies and I was giving him like lots of baths and stuff. And I didn't like the way the pink, it was like a little bit pink, so I just gave him the harness right now.
What kind of collar was it? Was it just a regular?
Just a regular PetSmart like collar.
Nylon?
Like a medium dog size.
Okay, it was like the texture of like nylon?
Yeah.
That's weird. And then pink from the collar or pink like from the skin reacting to
the
it?
The allergies.
Oh, okay.
But now he's on Apoquel.
Okay, so and then he's cool with the harness? Like there's no allergy there? Strange.
It's because, and then also he pulls on it and he has trouble breathing after more than like...
Oh yeah.
So like he was I felt like it was just like pulling on his neck more.
Yeah.
So, but he can use a regular collar too. It doesn't bother me. It was hard when I started leash training him because he kept pulling.
Okay, and how did you go about that?
So I just started doing like hay. I would stop until he would like get like less pulling, and then walk, and then I would just like, I don't know why I do it, but like I just hold it like this behind me, and I keep it like short, and then he just goes like that, but I don't give him like free rein, and then I don't go like this. So I just like hold it right here next to me, and then he just like walks side by side. And then if he tries to like run ahead or like poke himself, which he does occasionally, if he sees something, then I'll just be like, hey, Java, hey, and he stops. But yeah.
And then you said you've had him for 8 years?
Or? So he's 9 years old. I had him since he was half, 4 or 5 months. And recently he's been in my house for 2 months straight,
okay.
The whole time. So I've been trying to do the training, like, to get him back on track.
Yeah.
I started dog park, and that's where things went very sideways.
Yeah, dog parks are not the best place.
To reintroduce.
Yeah, because we can't, like, when owners ask, like, about dog parks, we say, you know, you can take your dog to dog park, but we don't know those other dogs, so we can't, like, control the area, so if they want to socialize, like, we do it here, because we know the dogs, we know how to control them, like, they're all e-collar trained, so that we can easily just, like, stop stuff if something happens, but, it's just, like, the other dog, that's, like, the issue for the dog parks, blah, blah, blah. So, with the leash walking, when he sees a dog, he lunges and barks.
He lunges and barks, and he won't, like, I can't stop him from being, like, aggressive. Like, I can't even get close. I need expert help. Like, I try to do, like, the go and turn the circle and, like, walk the other way. Like, do, like, a circle turn. Like, I'll, like, walk him and, like, even so if I see them, then I'll just, like, go. But, like, even if we're on the same path, he won't, like,
stop.
I can't. Like, he kind of, like, has, like, a very inkling that he knows it's bad. Like, I'm, like, let's keep walking. Like, and, like, I don't pay that dog attention. Mm-hmm. They're, like, but he just won't let it, like, he sees red.
Okay, I see.
And I don't know what he's going to do to them because I don't let the interaction happen.
Yeah.
And I tried, really, like, was trying to at first. Like, when I first started, I was, like, oh, not a big deal. And then I was, like, oh, like, he just gets, like, kind of, like, it's awkward situation. Yeah. And I don't know what the outcome will be, so that's why I kind of lately have been trying to avoid it and want to do it in a controlled environment.
Okay. And real quick, getting back to the collar. Was the collar on 24/7 or just you put it on for walks?
24/7.
Oh, okay. Because we might need a collar for the training.
Yeah, that's fine.
Because for harnesses, like they, like for the little guys, they probably give you more control because they're little, you know. But like sometimes, like I think the owner had like a harness on like a bulldog boxer mix, or was it a Rottweiler boxer mix? Maybe it was huge, and he had a harness, and he was just your arm was just gone.
Okay. No, the collar doesn't bother me. I just started doing this because he was pulling up his neck.
Yeah.
But he started the Apoquel, like, it's been 2 months, and his allergy rashes went away, and he's fully recovered.
Cool.
So he's just on that, and I take him baths, like, every week with the medication, though, so.
Okay.
He just was, like, allergic to everything, so.
Food or?
Grass.
Oh, okay.
And he would, like, roll around on the grass.
Okay.
But no, he's good. So that's, I don't mind the collar at all.
Okay, yeah, so, yeah, well, yeah, because harnesses promote pulling, so, like, harnesses are used for, like, I'm not saying use a flap on a collar because then he'll end up choking himself, you know. So the harnesses, though, they promote pulling, like, they're used for, like, huskies to pull, and then protection work. So, like, we'll have a dog, or, like, they'll have a dog on, like, a harness, and then, like, dogs have what it's called, it's opposition reflex. So if you pull back, they want to go forward because it's just reflex. When you pull left, they want to pull. If you pull left, they want to pull back. You know, they just want to go back against the pressure, you know. So in protection, like, they'll pull the dog and then release so they can pull back and then pull and then release. And then it gets frustrating. And that's how, like, they make the dog, like, aggravated and more, like, aggressive looking and everything like that. So we try to sell owners to avoid harnesses, even though you see, like, the no pull harnesses, like, there's no such thing because they make dogs pull. So we'll switch to the flat buckle collar. You don't have to have it on 24/7, you know. And in case you do see reactions, I'd probably try, like, maybe, like, leather collars just in case, like, try different materials.
No, he was on a collar all these years.
Oh.
So he's always been on a collar. The last 2 months, I switched him to the harness because his allergies were flaring up.
Oh, I see.
But I can easily switch him to a collar, not a big deal.
Yeah. Well, yeah. what else? So leash reactivity, and then just, like, figuring out, like, why or, like, what his goals are with other dogs, basically. you know, like what's going on in the head. And then anything else? So the walk, dogs.
I just want to walk him around the neighborhood without him feeling. Most people, when they see him, don't think that he's like.
Yeah.
Like he like gets cranky, and he doesn't. Even with kids, he doesn't even get bad.
Mm-hmm.
It's
just on the walk.
Sometimes some adults like, but very rare. Like,
yeah.
Like I guess if you're teasing him or like, you know, like. No one, my husband started to tease him a little bit and he started to get a little weird, but I told my husband like not to tease him and then, but I would say he doesn't get awkward around kids, it's just other dogs and in a social setting.
Okay.
With other dogs. And I would say I would like to just walk him without any confrontation.
Yeah. And then like, where do you see yourself in the future, like do you want that just, you know, we walk to the dog park and we go home, or like do you maybe go to restaurants with him and you want him to like just hang out and just have him chill?
He would always do that with me. He would always, like, even recently we went to get a cup of coffee and he just sits there,
mm-hmm.
doesn't move, will sit like this unless a dog comes.
Yeah.
And sometimes, like, there was no dog coming, so it was fine.
Okay.
A squirrel or a bunny sometimes, so get a little crazy.
Okay.
But that's, I think, I'm not saying it's every dog, but I've seen it more often with squirrels or bunnies, because they're, like, darting across the...
I see.
But, I would say that's the walking, and I would like him to socialize with other dogs, because I didn't realize he had a problem until I saw it.
Yeah. So with the socialization, it's just really like on him if he wants to. We can cut out the leash reactivity easily, which could spark, if we cut that out sometimes, like it can spark more curiosity and he can probably go back to it the way he was, maybe. So when I say that, it's, you know, as we're addressing it, instead of just seeing a dog and reacting, he's like, okay, who is this guy? You know, he's more curious, and then curious can turn into play, but that's just on him. It could be age, as he gets older, he's just kind of done with the dogs, you know, or just, you know, just trying to, you know, dogs change as they grow up, you know, like people too, like, you know, there's like those adults that are big party people, and then as they grow older, they're like, nah, I'm not into the party anymore. I have a family, I have responsibilities and all these things. But it can happen sometimes because it's kind of, we're just kind of cutting out the we're just putting discipline on him. So back to like what you see yourself, it's like, because we have programs, we have like the, you know, if you're, I'm pretty sure, I think you're doing in person, you want in person.
I honestly do think the biggest goal, because now that you're kind of saying the socialization, he's 9 years old, mm-hmm. so I don't feel like I have to, that's not fair to force him.
Yeah.
But I would say he needs to lose weight and he needs to drop like another 5 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
So walking is critical.
I see.
The lazy way for me was a dog park, but mm-hmm. I know that that's not apparently working.
Yeah, we have sometimes we'll get clients who are like, you know, their dog can lose weight with the dog parks, which is, I mean, not the dog parks, but pure daycare. I mean, before we had the treadmills, it was like, nah, not really the best. We got treadmills here now, and, you know, we do our best to, like, you know, if you want your dog to lose weight, we can put him on a treadmill just so they're walking throughout the day, rest, play, walk, rest, play. You know, they're actively doing something all day. With play, I mean, I've never seen anything with like dogs losing weight when playing with dogs, unless it's like swimming, maybe. I'm not sure.
Well, my parents didn't even walk him.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So,
okay.
Like, they didn't do anything. So, his walks are better, and I'm more controlled eating, no table food. So, like, he's already lost like a little bit, like a pound.
Oh, nice. Something.
So, he's doing it okay.
Yeah, and his nose looks pretty good for a Frenchie. It's pretty out, looks nice.
Yeah, he doesn't have.
He breathes, like he's quiet too, he's breathing.
The heat is his enemy.
Okay.
So even if it's cold and it's a decent sized walk, he could handle it.
Okay.
Not long, I'm saying just enough, but the heat is the problem.
Okay. So it sounds like you did some research on this. Like you said, you went to YouTube and everything. Is that how you found this?
No, one of my best friends used Jessie for her Beagle. Her name is Grizel. So she used Jessie prior to him having the facility.
Oh.
So she did in-home training and her dog had the e-collar. And
oh, nice.
So we're close friends. And then I just wanted to go with somebody that I knew had success with
it.
So then, and then I follow him on Instagram for like 2 to 3 years now.
Oh, cool.
So I always saw his posts and stuff anyway. So that's why I knew.
Cool.
Because I live in Oak Park, so I could find somewhere closer, but I just figure hopefully I can get this back on track
for
some type of training.
Yeah. So, what was the dog's name?
Java.
Oh, no, the Beagle.
Louis.
So he has that e-collar on and everything. Mm-hmm. What do you know? What do you know about the e-collar?
Well, Grizel, my best friend, said it's fine. It worked really well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I know. Like, she said she just said it works well and it worked for her. And I know that it's a type of collar, but I'm pretty much I'm open to anything because at the point that I have done, I could hurt myself.
Yeah.
Or get bit by a dog.
Yeah.
Honestly, if he gets bit by a dog, like, I would hate it, but he's egging them on.
Yeah.
Me trying to save him and the vet bill and hurting myself is with the other dog scares me more.
Yeah.
Because if he bites me, I think I might survive. If some big dog bites me, that would traumatize me.
For sure. E-collar would definitely help with that because it's not. You don't have to use your hands. You have to use your hands, but you're using your hands just pressing a button to get them out of there. Long term, if you do bring him to a dog park and you see him getting to that mode of bully, like the bully, you can just give a little button and then he's like, okay, and he stops.
Okay.
That's how it works. It's very, very helpful. You know, owners will say like, you know, my dog used to grab socks and stuff, run around the house. But then, like, since they have the e-collar, they can just press a button, they drop it, and they just stop. I mean, it's, they're like, it's very helpful, and it makes life less frustrating. But yeah, e-collar, the old term, and like the old school stuff is like shock collar.
Mm-hmm.
So Jessie likes to put it, e-collar as electric, but not electricity going, you know, like, it's not like, you know, when we tap or like press the button on Java, it's not gonna just go through his whole body like a shock. You know, it's a muscle, contraction muscle. So at physical therapists, they use it, like they put a little patch and like it moves the muscle. It's called a TENS unit. They also have the commercials for like, if you wanna build like a six pack, they put it over and it's just like move your stomach.
Mm-hmm.
So it's that same, that same like idea, it's a TENS unit as a collar basically.
Mm-hmm.
It just moves the muscle. So like if I have it here, I'm going higher, you'll just see my thumb like just move like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the reason why we have so much success with this because it's physical. It's something that's moving, it's touching them. It's like prong collars.
Mm-hmm.
You know how like they're like the spiky collar ones, like they close if you pull up because it's supposed to mimic a dog bite. So sometimes it works and sometimes it's a step towards like good training because you can correct the dog, you know. The only issue is, let's say your dog is really well trained in prong collar and, you know, does everything, walks well and everything, you know, it's just doing well. The moment you take the leash off, now you don't have control. And then another con would be, let's say Java's a good walker with the prong, right? And then a dog comes by, and then, you know, you give your harshest, like, leash pop, so that the leash pop is, like, when it closes like that, and a snap. You do give your harshest, and, like, say your harshest is, like, a 7, but he's at a 10. You're never going to reach that 7. Like, I could do my harshest, and he's still, I don't care, because dogs won't care. Jessie had a chihuahua, a little chihuahua, and he was reactive, too. And then when he would do the leash pops, I think Boncho would, like, do 3 spins, like, and then just go right back to the dog barking. So it doesn't do anything. So those are like 2 cons there. So it goes like positive only, you know, food only is like when the ceiling is really low. Like if you don't have food, your dog is not going to do it. Or if your dog sees food, squirrel, So I was thinking, I can get the food later, but I can't get the scroll later, so I'm gonna go for the scroll. And then it goes to gentle leader, where it just gives you more control with the nose. With Frenchies, I don't know if that can work, because the nose is so small.
Yeah.
And then it goes to prong collar, and the cons for that is taking off the leash, and then just not being able to override the mind in that setting. And then ECOG. So ECOG gets us to like close, the closest is to like 190%. Yeah. So it's like, you know, Chesha will say, you know, if you said, I can fix your internet, but if I do it this way, it'll be 50% chance. If I do it this way, it's a 90-100% chance. We're gonna go for the 90-100% chance, you know. So that's why he always does ECOG for 6 months, for dogs 6 months and older. As soon as it hits 6 months, ECOG. We've had some puppies, like 4 months old, do ECOG, and they did really well. But so that's a little more nuanced. But ECOG is physical, so dogs are physical. So if a little puppy ran up on Java and was just going at him, like just play, Java would probably bite, you know? And then the pup's, oh, okay, I don't play with Java. I'm gonna go away or something like that. You know, I respect that. So it's the same thing here, because we can override the power. So shock collars have 1 to 5 levels. Our brand we use has 127. That 5 on the old school ones is equal to 127. So we can just be very specific to Java, you know? So like the issue would be like, you know, a 3 would make my dog yelp, but a 2 he wouldn't listen. So that's where they got stuck. With the dog trail, we can, you know, if a 50 is too high and 40 is too low, go to 45. It's easy. So we can override mindsets of like flight mode, of like the reactivity. We can override it because we need to make it uncomfortable for him to the point where like, okay, I can't even do that. I don't want to do it. But the way we train isn't like, you know, let's turn all the way up and just slam the dog. You know, that's not how we train. We need to teach Java first how to turn e-collar on and how to turn e-collar off so that we can let him know that you control it. Like, this is all on you. And Java will never know it's you pressing the button. But the prong collar and like, you know, leashes and everything, like dogs see the leash attached to you. So if you were to correct him, sometimes dogs see that and they're like, what are you doing? And they stop and they like might fight you on that. So it's more confrontational.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, because like you can have the e-collar at home when you don't have the leash. Like you can have the collar on.
Yeah.
And if he starts, but I'm not walking him. Because right now, if he thinks this right now, he likes it because he's like, walk. When he sees my leash, he's just like,
I
love going on walks.
Yeah.
But I don't want him to look at the leash and think negative.
Like, exactly, yeah.
But so, the collar's going to be on him, so he's, like you said, he's not going to notice.
Yeah, so he won't know you're pressing the button. So like if, like for resource guard, for example, when dogs are resource guard for food, trainers will say no, and then like leash pop or like something physical, and the dog sees this, and what the dog sees like, okay, we're fighting for this food. But ECOG, we just correct it, and the dog doesn't know it's from us, they think it's like the universe, you know? But ECOG is not all correcting, but there's a level of discipline that needs to be shown to Java. So with reactivity, do you have any questions so far about e-collar?
No, I'm okay with e-collar as long as it works for Frenchies that overheat. Like if it's a safe thing for Frenchies, then I'm okay with it. And then I would say like, how do I get him to, you know, what kind of program or, you know, my husband, he had to fly to India because he had a family emergency with COVID, so it's just mostly me training him right now. But my husband has like, a lot of expenses, and he told me, like, don't overdo it with the dog training. That was his call out. He's like, just be quick. Is there something I could do that's like, I could do it in pieces or like, you know, at home or like anything just so that I don't go? Because like, my friend did like at home training, and she said it was like pretty pricey for her at that point.
Yeah, for
you. So I'm just looking for something like, I know that I could definitely do more, but I'm looking for like something I'm doing.
Yeah, so since we're just doing it for activity and you're just focused on the walk, it'd probably be like a 6-week program. So if in person though, so it'd be like an hour a week we meet somewhere, and then like that day, so like Sundays at 3, every Sunday for 6 Sundays. We have payment plans as well. The 6-week program is just a grand. The payment plan, and then this consultation will be credited towards it. Payment plan will be 500 down, minus the 135, then 250, then 250 after the third, and then after this, before the 6, I think. But with the reactivity, the reason why I think it'll be 6 is because if you react to humans, typically there's like a reactivity like spectrum, like a scale of like what goes away first. So first is humans. We don't even have to address humans sometimes, it just goes away, like it just disappears. So we don't see the reactivity. Then it goes dogs, like normal, calm, walking past dogs, they just go away. The variable here is like, you know, or not the variable, but the next one would be other dogs that react to us. So like calm dogs, and then energy, like a lot of energy dogs that, like, you know, if you're walking and like we walk by a calm dog, cool. We walk, we see another dog, and the dog's barking at us, like what is he gonna do, you know, with that energy. And then we have just like the surprise. So like I'm not familiar with the area anymore. I'm from the south suburbs. Is Oak Park north or
so
west?
Oak Park, you know where North Riverside Mall is at?
Oh, like Cicero and everything.
Yeah.
Oh,
so okay. Oak Park is like right next to Burr and Cicero.
Oh, okay, okay.
It
so
it took me 23 minutes to get here.
Oh, that's not bad.
Yeah.
But yeah, for like the city folk here, you know, they turn a corner, there's a dog there. Like there's so many dogs walking.
No, Oak Park's like that. Everyone has a dog.
Okay.
So that's why I'm like, every time I go on a walk, there's at least 5 dogs.
Yeah.
At least. So
sometimes it's good because then we can move on faster. The more dogs we see, the more we can address. If we see a dog like once a week, then it's gonna take a long time because we need to see dogs to.
We see a dog every time we go on a walk.
Okay, good.
That's why I've just been like, oh my god.
Yeah.
And then it's like, please be good, please be good. And then I'm just like, okay, now I'm like trying to like go on a different block. If I see the dog, but like if they turn a corner, then I can't really prepare, you know?
Yeah.
So that's what I need help with.
Yeah. So it's like the humans, calm dogs, reactive dogs, and then the you turn a corner, there's a dog right here. Like, what's gonna happen? The first two classes would be heel, which is walk in the stage and you sit when I stop. And the reason why this we choose this first is because it allows Java to learn how does e-collar turn on, when does it turn off. And the reason why the humans kind of go away if he's reacting to humans sometimes is because just the amount of discipline and focus he needs to have on you. So that first class he might be super tired because you can control him physically, right? You can keep him here on your side physically.
Yeah.
But mentally.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, but you have to control him mentally now.
Yeah, for sure.
So he might be very exhausted and pans a lot. So just keeping that in mind. And then, so that's two classes. And then, so you have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you have 4 left. We'd like to teach recall, like come called, for 2 classes, because it's important. If you don't see, like, it's because the program goes, so 6 weeks is I walk my dog to the dog park and back, and I need to call my dog from the dog park when I need him to come. Then it's the 9-week, whereas I walk my dog to the dog park, I need him to come when called, and then I take him to restaurants, I need him to, like, being a down command for 3 to 2 hours, whatever. And then the 12-week is all that plus you take hiking off leash. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like you're just like, you know, the 6-week is, yeah.
I don't need off leash and the restaurant important, so.
So the reason why recall would be important, even if you don't plan on having him on leash, would be if you had an incident where, again, maybe he slipped out the collar or slipped out the leash, like how are you gonna get him back, you know, with the e-collar? Yeah. And then throughout all these classes you're doing homework to practice, and then we're seeing how is the reactivity progressing, how's it going, you know. And then we have 2 more classes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, yeah, 2 more classes. And then this we can like focus on like walks or something, or like, you know, if you're still struggling, we can do like a session, just we go for a walk and we help you out. What you can also do is add a command, like do another command maybe, like a stationary command, like a stay, go to your bed or whatever. But We don't give you what you don't need, so if you don't care.
He knows how to go to his bag. Mm-hmm. He knows how to stay mm-hmm. enough.
Okay.
Like, I taught him stay mm-hmm. sit. Mm-hmm. So he kind of still has a little muscle memory on those.
Okay.
But the look at me, he'll know.
Yeah. So with the look at me command, we don't teach look at me. We just teach it's just heel,
okay.
And then the dogs just end up looking at us. Like we don't teach that part. The first class, you might see him just like staring at you the whole time while he's walking, but that goes away.
Okay.
So don't worry about that. If you just want to like just you know we're just walking, chill out. You don't even want to remove. Sometimes owners don't like that or whatever. What else are we missing? So a lot of owners will ask like, you know, well, how long or when does the e-collar come off or like, you know, at what point or whatever, you know? It's on when you need it. So if you know you're gonna go for a walk, it's probably gonna be on. If he's in the home and he's perfect, like you don't need to say anything, he's just kind of hanging out with you guys, then you don't need the e-collar.
Well, he knows not to jump on the sofas, mm-hmm. but me. But I catch him sometimes.
Oh, okay.
And it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
Like, when my parents let him get on the sofa, but he knows not to get on the sofa at my house,
mm-hmm.
but like, he'll sneak it sometimes, so.
Yeah, so if you wanted to e-collar for that, you can do that. But if it's like, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's your house, your rules. You know, you pay for the dog. You pay for the vet bill, you pay for the food, it's your rules, it's your house. You know, I'm not going to tell you what to do with your dog in the home. Because like other trains will have like a don't pet your dog, feed your dog only from your hand, and then make all these rules and has like nothing to do with anything. It's just too much work, it's unrealistic for the owner. We've never had to do that, we've never had to. I mean, unless you get those severe cases where it's like, all right, you need to chill out with your dog at home because you're telling him to do, you're telling him no, but then like you're loving him and then it's like, he's like, I don't think you want me to, you know, they get confused. But like I said, if he's fine in the home, you don't care about the jumping or if you want to address it, that's up to you. You can let us know, we can help you out with that if you'd like to do some in-home stuff. And then speaking of like jumping when you catch him, it's called opportunistic behavior. So for example, like when we drive on the highway, like Jesse uses this in his consultations, we'll ask like, you drive on the highway, and most people say, yeah, and then like, do you speed? Like, or do you go to speed limit? Like, no, we don't, because it's, you know, no one goes to speed limit, it's 60, you know? And then he's like, okay, so what happens when you see a squad car, like parked at the little alley, like the side or whatever, and then like, we slow down. Opportunistic behavior, we want to get away with something, we'll do it, you know? If we see a chance. Same thing with dogs, so it's what I'm trying to get at is.
Yeah, like if he knows I'm on the same floor as him, he won't jump on the sofa.
Yeah.
And then I go upstairs and then I'll see him jump off right before I get
downstairs.
Oh,
okay.
So he's like sneaky.
Yeah.
Sometimes he doesn't though, but like that's not the end of the world. I could definitely live with that.
Yeah.
But it would be nice to correct.
And then it kind of. Or relates over to e-collar sometimes. So like owners will say, I take the e-collar off and he's like, you know, he's like being a brat. It's the same thing there, opportunistic behavior. If he knows that he can do certain things without the e-collar on, he's gonna do it. You know, it's just it's nature. So it has nothing to do with you or the homework you're not messing up. It has nothing to do with us as trainers. It's just, like I said, it's just nature. It's just gonna happen. And this is kind of a forever thing. You know, if you go for a walk, so you want that e-collar on because we can't account for life. We can't, you know, what if one day like a car crash happens right next to you and he freaks out and he gets out of that flat collar, well, how are you gonna connect to him, you know? So we're not saying that you're gonna be tapping and like, you know, shocking him all his life. It's gonna be a lot of tapping in the beginning. Mm-hmm. The more you tap now, the less you'll tap in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So like, you know, Jesse will say like, you know, for his dogs, like he only taps like once every 2 months because he's already, you know, for the train. Any questions?
So I guess my biggest concern are Z's, and I guess if the obedience training, with the way that he is, in order for him to ever do daycare, he would definitely, like, I guess, like, my question is, like, I would I think you talked about it and maybe have to give it up, but like I would like him to socialize with other dogs still. So that would be my goal.
Yeah, does he
My mom had a dog. Like he gets along with dogs if he knows them or whatever. He used to. He can. We went to the dog park another time and he was just getting along with some. But it's like the what we talked about, like training three or four of him seeing another dog.
Yeah.
Like, I want him to be able to socialize or be comfortable with another dog.
Yeah.
That would be my goal.
Yeah, so... Just depending on how we're going to the program, we can use a class. Like, if you have a friend that has a dog that he's never met before, or like that golden doodle we can use, or like some a dog that he has issues or has never met, and then we can schedule a class so I can teach you how to socialize.
Okay.
And like it, so like if you ever have a friend that has a dog and you want them to see if they play, I can teach you an exercise that will allow them to get to know each other without conflict.
Okay, that'd be nice.
But you're also welcome to bring to daycare, and then we can see how it is and everything, evaluate him. And then we'll have for our daycare we use the tools and everything, so like if we get a dog that's trained in e-collar, we can use the e-collar, so we enforce everything. So like we'll do like duration work here, which means go on this bed and then you need to stay here and watch everything go by. You need to lay down. I mean, he stands, sit, but he needs to like be on that his little bed. And then we'll have the e-collar and the playpen and socializing him and everything. What else?
Oh yeah, that would be, I think, yeah, I definitely am up for the obedience training. Because I think we want to start a family too in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And like, the last thing you need him to do is like...
Yeah.
This behavior is, I would say it's not perfect. It's manageable, I want to get it better for sure. He doesn't hurt children, but I don't want it to go down even worse, where then I'm like concerned that he'll hurt like babies or children.
Yeah, and then it'd be harder since you have kids and a dog, and it's just a lot.
It's too much work, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. What else? So we talked about the e-collar, programs, and how much does he weigh?
He is 35.
35 pounds, okay. Trying to figure out like what he taught.
He sometimes wears medium, large. I didn't like some of the clothes, but he's 35. He should be around 27-ish.
Okay. Yeah, because we have different models for e-collars. We have like it's called the 280C, where it's for like, the smaller dog. We have like the 2... 2300.
Oh, how much are the e-collars, yeah.
So, they range from 200 to 300.
Okay.
$300 e-collars for like the big boys, the big dogs. But I'm trying to think. Since we're doing free activity, I'll have to see if we might go with the big boy collar, just so we don't get to a point where, like if we choose like the little dog collar, sometimes it's not always for, like they have like the listener, like you need to buy this collar for this dog. But then like we get the pit bulls who are so intense and they're small. If we pick the collar that the doctor recommends, we would have gotten nowhere. Okay. So we need the big boy collar for the small pit bulls since they're so intense and reactive and aggressive or whatever. Java, I'll think on it.
Is there not a medium one?
Oh yeah, it's like the small one and then like the medium one and then there's like the big boy collar. But what I don't want is like you to spend money and then the collar's too weak, we need the big boy collar. It's time, and everything. But I'll get back to you on that, and then I'll ask Jesse's opinion just to see. But I don't think we'll need the big boy collar. I think only like the medium would be fine, sometimes dogs surprise us and they'll take the small, like a Great Dane who's on a little Chihuahua collar.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll talk to Jesse, see his opinion on it. I think the medium, 2300 NCP would be fine. Trying to think what else. What other carbon questions they need to ask. But like I said, reactivity should be pretty simple. It's just like the socialization aspect of it. It's just kind of like on him. You know, if he wants to play, he can play. If he doesn't, then it's just he doesn't want to play.
Okay.
As long as he doesn't, result in fight, we can just teach him to like avoid a situation, or we can stop him, his behavior. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That we can do. But the play part, you know, I don't know. That's on him.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Has he ever worn a muzzle before?
Before considering dog training, I was wanting him to wear a muzzle.
Mm-hmm.
Because
this dog training?
Yeah,
okay.
Like I was like, I wonder how much a muzzle would cost.
Yeah.
But I knew that was not the only solution. Like,
yeah.
I don't have a muzzle for him.
Okay. Because if you do want to socialize him, we'll have to muzzle him just in case, just to be safe on the safe side. But for the French Bulldogs, there's special muzzles. I don't know if you've seen them.
Yeah, I guess I could.
I thought they're like masks.
I could buy a muzzle for him. I don't have a problem doing that.
Yeah.
I would have to buy a few on Amazon to see how they fit first.
Yeah. If you're a muzzle trainer and you want to do the socialization, I start as soon as possible, just so that when we get to that point, he's already comfortable with the muzzle and we don't need to be focused on the muzzle at that moment, you know, because we'll tell owners, you know, you want to socialize your dog, or if they're aggressive with humans, start muzzle conditioning now. Like,
yeah.
Even before you pay for the program, just start with muzzle conditioning. So that, because sometimes they'll put it off, like, eh, whatever, and then we get to that point, and the dog hates the muzzle, like they're cutting off their face and everything,
mm-hmm.
They're trying to pull it off, and it's like, well, you know.
Okay.
But I recommend you do muzzle training, so it's, you know, with food and everything, you know, apply the muzzle, food, taking off the muzzle, food, just keep repeating it throughout the day. You can use his meals, so if he's eating kibble, you can, you know, use that whole meal for breakfast as for muzzle. Like, he only eats out of the muzzle. We have a few videos, so I'll send you them, just to how to muzzle train. But there's tons of YouTube videos, too, if you want to just do research on your own and see what best suits you. But there's no really wrong way of muzzle training. The only wrong way to muzzle train is to not just do it. That's the only way.
Okay.
What else? Any questions?
I guess if, like, I would talk to my husband first and then see how that works, but then, like, how do people do the training? Is it individual? Is it group? Do I join a group session?
Yeah, so I'll give you your options. So you have in-person, daycare and train, and then board and train. If you're trying to save money, in-person training, because we get more money from board training than daycare training, so in-person training, you save more money. The cons and pros for in-person. Con is it takes a little longer, that's all. Pros, you're doing everything yourself from ground zero. You know, you're seeing how to troubleshoot stuff and seeing how, okay, this happens, so let's fix it this way, and you're doing it. You know, it's we don't touch the dog. We would meet at, like, you know, either in home or at a park, and I meet you guys, it'd be you and your husband, and I just tell you what to do, and then you do it all the work.
Mm-hmm.
Daycare and train, you bring Java in for a regular daycare. He can play, he just enjoys all the regular daycare stuff, but we also train him. Pros is we get everything done right away. Like, we teach everything day one. We videotape everything as we're doing it, so we can see how he took it, what happened, how we fixed certain stuff if we encounter whatever. Con is, it's tied to us, the trainers. So then we have the follow-up. So then after his program, you come for a follow-up, and then, you got a 10-day, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. Tuesday, we teach everything, and then Thursday, the full videos will probably be posted. You watch the videos, you practice, and then the follow-up comes, shows what you've been practicing, you show us, and then we say, okay, you're doing this correct, but this needs a little work on, and we'll help you, and then we transfer that for you. Board and train, same ordeal as daycare training, except the follow-ups are more longer because you don't get to practice when he's here, you know what I'm saying? But it sounds like you want to do it in person anyways, right?
Yeah, I want to learn how to do it.
Yeah.
If I have more money, I would like to do, like, I don't want to say I'm lazy, but like, of course it would be nice to have him do, I think, the second one.
Board and train or daycare and train?
Daycare train, yeah. I think the second one, mm-hmm. because like, it's helping me like with the other dogs and like that, but then I'm just the pawn as like, what if he doesn't realize he has to do that with me?
Yeah.
And then that defeats the purpose that I came for. So I would say I'm okay with in-person training.
So, and just a heads up, the e-car's transferable. So what I mean, like, we have to transfer everything for you. Like, for example, when we work with couples, let's say that like the wife goes first, or like one of the partners goes, partner number one, let's say partner number one goes first, right? And they do all the hard work, right? Then they hand the dog to partner number two, and it's like they don't have to do anything because like they already did the hard work. So it's very transferable. So, but I get what you're saying with the socialization aspect of it. Like, we're more disciplinary, we're more of a discipline persona to him in the playpen in here, because he's like, these guys mean business, but then like he sees mom, he's like, oh mom, like, you know, he might act different with you, or maybe be more bratty or whatever, but if you do it, like you said, it's more relationship based with you, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, in person I recommend 6 weeks, since we're just dealing with reactivity, it's probably 6 weeks. Sometimes if we hear that the reactivity is like too intense, we'll push for 9, but I'm leaning more towards 6 for you. But at the end of the day, it's your choice. You can always add classes or buy another class, and you can always save classes. So if we get 5 classes done, and he's perfect, that's it, he's good. You have 1 class left, you can save it until like you want to socialize him and get that set up, and then like, hey, you know, I talked to this friend, we can socialize him, like, do you want to help me out? And then you can use that class, or you can just save it till.
I think I want to, if everything works out, I want to help with the golden doodle.
Okay.
That's my brother's dog, and that dog has been going to training since it's been born.
So. Oh, nice. Cool.
So it's like very well trained. But if she's just happy and hyper.
Okay.
So she doesn't know.
Happy go lucky.
Yeah, she doesn't know any better. So she's like, why is this dog being so mean to me?
Yeah.
She can't really understand.
Yeah, so that'd be a good dog to use, since there will be no conflict. So sometimes if we get a dog, if we get both dogs who are iffy, if one goes at it, then the other will go at it for sure. But if
she
get a
doesn't
dog,
go at it, she gets scared. She doesn't know any better. So she's like, why are you attacking me?
Yeah.
She doesn't know.
So that'd be a good dog to use. And if it doesn't work out, we can bring a dog here as well who's the same personality. Like, we have a few dogs here are just like, you know, we'll use it for socialization, and then when the dog goes at them, they go right back like, oh, were you playing with me? What were you doing? Like, let's play again. Obviously taking the safety precautions. They're then being muzzled and everything. But that can work. Your brother's golden doodle. What else? You're out in Oak Park, right?
Yeah, so that's the thing, like, I didn't know, I have no problem coming here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if Oak Park is, I live by Ridgeland and Jackson, basically like Oak Park Avenue and Central or something, mm-hmm. and like Jackson, so it's like 25 minutes away, but I didn't know that, like, I was under the impression that like I would come here and get the training.
Yeah, so, we can do it at home, so.
Okay, but I didn't want it to be too far for the trainers here if it's inconvenient.
Oh, no, yeah, I'll, 9:45 on Sundays today, I go all the way up to, is it Wilmette?
Oh, okay.
Like a 30-minute drive.
Okay.
And then like Sundays is when I do all my in-home stuff, so I'll start north and work my way all the way down, and I've been down all the way to like Lamont.
Oh, wow.
You're Lamont's?
Yeah,
I worked all the way down to Lamont before. So Berwyn, Cicero area, Oak Park, that's fine.
Yeah.
So we can definitely get that set up and everything. And since you're available on Sundays, that works perfect with my schedule. So I'll send a follow-up email about everything we talked about and then prices and everything and options for you. A collar, we sell collars here. But I'll send you a link to Amazon in case you want to order it yourself. And then, so I'll send the follow-up email. It'll also contain a sign agreement thing. So you just assign that. Once I see that you've signed it, we'll begin the billing process. Payment plan or pay in full, it's up to you. You can send that in response to my email. Let me know what, you know, once you guys decide and you're ready, let me know. We'll get that invoiced. And then once the invoice has been set and paid, we begin the scheduling process. So if you get it all done, like, you know, whenever, we can start that the next following Sunday. Since I have, because I only have 1, 2, 3.
So I have a question. Yeah. Okay, so this is important. My husband is in India still because of the family emergency. And mm-hmm. I don't know if you know what's going on. Like, so they banned the borders. But I don't know if it helps having him with me with the training, mm-hmm. because like to me that's important, like mm-hmm. because my dog, even now that I'm practicing, mm-hmm. is kind of just listening to me mm-hmm. and not paying attention to him.
Yeah.
And I don't want that to happen.
For sure.
So
yeah.
I'm
yeah.
trying to say, like, can I start when my husband comes? Or
yeah, it's up to you when you start, you know. Yeah.
But I don't know if it I guess that, and then I don't want to create a bad habit where he's like only listening to me and not yeah. listening to my husband, but yeah, or I can find out when he comes back. But
so you can either wait till he comes back, and if you do want to start it, we videotape everything, and it's high quality. We got good quality sound. We put a mic in the client so they hear everything, they see everything. Uh-huh. But then, like you said, you do miss out on the experience of like him doing it and like me coaching him and everything. So he's getting like the professional.
Yeah.
Teaching of it. So yeah, you can wait for him to come back.
It's not gonna be that long. Like, it might be like 2 or 3 more weeks, but like it might be worth my while because.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask him first.
Yeah.
He might say I don't want to do it.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
And then I'll just do it myself.
Yeah.
You know?
And then e-collar, it's associated. So like, if Java finds out or figures out, oh, when I'm walking with dad, I can get away with certain things, he's gonna take advantage
yeah.
of it. It won't ruin your training, and it won't, like, you can technically untrain a dog if you're not doing the homework, if you're not being strict, if you're letting things slide. You can make him back to you how he was before training, after training. But whatever your husband does wrong, it wouldn't affect his training overall with you. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no. Yeah.
And that's what you were saying. Yeah,
yeah, but yeah, like if my husband doesn't want to do it, then
that, yeah.
I'm like, okay, that doesn't matter to me. But yeah, no, I think that's good because I just really want him to, you know, be better for the next few years
mm-hmm.
and not be a brat. I mean, yeah. I was not used to him like this. So I was like, I'm like, oh my God, John, what happened to you? You were so good before.
Anything else?
No, just, I think we covered everything.
Awesome. If any questions pop up, you have my email.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll send that follow-up email most likely tomorrow with everything you talked about. And then in case you don't see it, check the spam.
No, yeah, that's fine. I'll definitely check it out. And I'm good. Let's see what my husband says, and then I'll get the muzzle, and then just follow the instructions on the email.
Cool. Anything else? Awesome.
No.
Well, it was
nice meeting you.
Nice meeting you. I'll go ahead and walk you out.
Alright. Hopefully. Not so much traffic today.
Oh, yeah.